Okay. Hi, everyone. John Michael, thanks for having me on. We'll just let people trickle in for a minute, I think. Very good. Well, so my name is Jamie McCabe. I'm one of the interventional cardiologists at the University of Washington. I am the head of our interventional cardiology program and run our structural heart program specifically. And I was asked to join today to talk a little bit about valvular heart disease and answer any questions that might come up and maybe provide a little bit of an overview to start. So I want to see if I can do that. Let me see if I can start a little screen share. And just do this here. Okay, hopefully you can see my screen.
In presentation mode.
Okay, thank you. How about that?
Perfect.
Thank you, John Michael. Good. So these are, the point here is not to to do kind of a adult learning program for an hour, but rather to just show a few slides, kind of set some framework around what valvular heart disease means to us, or to me, and kind of where we're putting our energy, and then perhaps open it up to everyone to ask questions. So I think it's important to recognize when we're talking about valvular heart disease that it is plural. There are four valves in the heart. There are two valves that separate the upper and lower chambers of the heart. They're the tricuspid valve and the mitral valve. And then there are two valves that separate the main pumping chambers, these bottom chambers of the heart, from the destination of blood moving forward. And for the pulmonary valve, that subsequently sends blood to the lungs before it returns. And the aortic valve is like the exit door for the heart. So there are four valves in the heart. And these valves, though it's a complex geometry, but basically they provide direction to blood flow so that used blood returns from being used by your muscles or your kidney or your whatever, and it enters the heart and goes through the tricuspid valve, and then it's pushed forward to the pulmonic valve where it's pushed forward to the lungs, and then it comes in through the mitral valve and then the aortic valve, and then it becomes your circulation. So it's a very linear process, even though it's not a perfect straight line that blood is flowing in. And in fact, it's this directionality that is the purpose of your heart valves in general. When your heart beats, it doesn't push blood in any direction, it just squeezes. And it's the valves which open or close that sort of allow blood to go in the appropriate direction and keep blood from going in the inappropriate direction. And that's really their job. That's it. Kind of like check flow valves or one-way doors, whatever you might want to call them. So pretty simple jobs, but there are ways that these valves can go wrong. So if you consider it almost like a turnstile effect where just keeping things going in the right direction, the ways that these can fail include the valves sort of developing rusty hinges where just they don't swing open well, and your heart has to push harder and harder to get that door open. And perhaps as it gets more and more rusty, it goes from just pushing harder to open it all the way to pushing harder, but it's not even opening all the way. And the resulting kind of pathway for blood is smaller. And so that's sometimes described as narrowing. In the medical terminology, we call that stenosis, The most common version being aortic stenosis. But you can think of it like rusty hinges on that exit door of the heart. The other way that things can go wrong with valves is that they get leaky. They basically are broken one way or another, where that sort of one-way directionality of blood flow is compromised. And so leaky valves, often called regurgitant valves or having regurgitation, or insufficient valves is another sort of medical term for that. It just means that when the heart, the main pumping chambers squeeze, even though, you know, one valve is closing to keep blood from going backwards, it maybe isn't closing completely, or there's a flap that's kind of come untethered. And so some of the blood that is supposed to be going forward to be your circulation is instead going backwards and creating kind of this ocean wave phenomenon with blood moving to and fro. And that increases the congestion in the heart and also limits the amount of blood or circulation going forward. So you get sort of inefficient heartbeats in that way because you're still squeezing hard, but only sending out a fraction of the blood that you should be. So those are kind of the ways that valves can go bad generally. There are certain scenarios where the valves can have both of these things, both sort of kind of narrowed or stenosed and leaky. But by and large, it's one of the two. And so the most common forms of valvular heart disease, and these are just sort of like code words that you might have heard or been told at one point or another, include aortic stenosis, mitral regurgitation, so that's leaky mitral valve, leaky tricuspid valve, also called tricuspid regurgitation, and then a couple that are less common, mitral stenosis, which is not unheard of, but is not as frequent, and aortic regurgitation, also not quite as frequent. I didn't put anything up here about the pulmonic valve, which is that valve that separates the heart, the right side of the heart from the lungs. Pulmonic valve issues tend to be things that you are born with more likely than not, slightly different than for folks who acquire these conditions over time, which is generally speaking how the ones I've listed here occur. Not always, but more often than not. So what are symptoms of valvular heart disease? Well, the most common symptom of valvular heart disease is sort of fatigue or lethargy, or just feeling run down or the wind's out of your sails. It's a hard one because there's obviously lots of reasons as we mature that can happen. And so just being fatigued all the time doesn't necessarily mean you have heart disease or valvular heart disease, but certainly if you have valvular heart disease and you're feeling run down, it may be related. And we often in clinic talk to people and they say, well, I'm 85 now. I'm not who I once was. And that's true, but it is confusing to separate those things out. And because it may be more than just sort of aging. The other symptoms that you can run into would be breathlessness, particularly breathlessness when you're exerting yourself or trying to move around more. Think about, going up and down stairs, carrying laundry, trying to mow the yard. For some people, it's as simple as trying to walk to the bathroom can be really hard. Chest pain is less common a phenomenon in valvular heart disease. It can be related to aortic stenosis, but it's not usually the first thing people feel. And then the last one is passing out or feeling somewhat faint. That's another one of those symptoms that can be related to a lot of different things. And so is not a perfect indicator of valvular heart disease, but certainly if you had valvular heart disease of any shape or form and you passed out, that would be kind of a warning sign that we'd really want to know about. So those are generally speaking the most common types of symptoms. And so the question becomes, well, how do we fix these things? And for these rusty hinges, unfortunately, there isn't a WD-40. We don't have a great medicine for that. There are medications that can help with valvular heart disease, particularly diuretics like Lasix, for example, is a medicine to just help get rid of some of the congestion. Doesn't fix the valve in any way, so it's not getting to the root cause of the problem, but can certainly make life more tolerable and improve breathing. Generally speaking, we've tried to approach this using what we call a structural heart service, which means basically it's a multidisciplinary team of surgeons and cardiologists. So sort of folks who do things in a more open, invasive way, and things who do people who do things in a more minimally invasive way, to get to, you know, improving the plumbing of the heart. And my particular job is as on the more less invasive side, excuse me, using a catheter-based approach to fix the heart kind of from the leg arteries and veins most of the time. That's not the only way to do things, but that's where I'm going to focus just because that's my area of expertise. But my days are spent in sort of a shared care model with a surgeon or multiple surgeons and people who are experts at imaging and so forth, so that we bring all different opinions to the table about what's the best way to fix a particular problem, or does it need to be fixed at all, for that matter. And sometimes the answer is, well, open heart surgery is really a better way to do this. And sometimes the answer is, well, a catheter-based or minimally invasive surgery is sort of the better way to do this. And so we want to provide all of those particular opinions. A really classic example of this sort of minimally invasive heart valve repair replacement is something called TAVR, transcatheter aortic valve replacement. And so for people who have rusty hinges on their aortic valve and they have that narrowing of the exit door of the heart where blood is just not getting out very well, we can actually put a new valve in there, typically from the leg artery. And we don't actually take out the old valve. We just put a new one right inside the existing bad valve and kind of inflate or deploy that new valve, and it pins the old valve out of the way, pins it to the walls of the surrounding structures and with the scaffolding or the caging of the new valve. And then inside it has new flappers that do the job of going up and down. And so those valves, they look like these. They have a framework that is various metal alloys, but the tan parts are in here, and in here are the flappers that would go up and down with the heartbeat. And I put this in here just because I wanted to address terminology, because that comes up a lot and I think it's a bit confusing. All heart valves have a structure and a size that is usually created with a metal or plastic frame. That does not make them mechanical valves. So mechanical valves are defined by flappers being metal, meaning that the tan part in here, where these, what we call leaflets or flappers, if those were metal, that would be a mechanical valve. Those are only put in by open heart surgery, and they are generally reserved for people under the age of 65 or so, because their real benefit is that they last a very long time. And so if you're young enough that you might have to think about 70 years of life with a man-made valve, you know, mechanical valve might be a really good choice for you. The downside to mechanical valves is that they require really strict adherence to blood thinners, which can be a bit challenging. So there are risk calculations about the pros and cons of blood thinners versus the durability of various valves. And generally speaking, we don't use mechanical valves in people over about 65 years old. So these are tissue valves. Even though they have metal components, metal framework, the leaflets are made either out of cow or pig parts. People love to ask, is this a cow valve or a pig valve? Honestly, you can see how these two valves are structured so differently. It's actually not the cow or the pig part that we pick. based on. It's more how these particular valves would fit within the shape and size of your heart. And but they are nevertheless, the one on the left is the pig one and the one on the right is the, or I did that backwards. The one on the left is the cow one and the one on the right is the pig one. And so these are just two classic valves. There's another really classic minimally invasive heart repair system that I just wanted to briefly touch on. And it's called transcatheter edge-to-edge transcatheter edge-to-edge repair, or TEER. But it more commonly goes by the brand name MitraClip. And this is one of those Kleenex versus tissue things where Kleenex is a brand name, but they're really called tissues. Everyone sort of calls this MitraClip, even though the concept is called TEER. And MitraClip is a way to address a leaky mitral valve, which is one of the more common conditions that can happen in terms of valvular heart disease. The idea behind this concept is that you're born with more mitral valve than you need. And so if you have a part that's not working well and is really leaky, you can effectively staple that area closed and leave all the healthy valve to do the job of opening and closing like it's supposed to. And so you end up with a picture like in the middle here where you sort of staple an area closed and you have the other parts of the valve open and close like normal. You can't, now this is a Goldilocks type procedure. If you don't staple enough of the leaky part closed, then it'll still be a little leaky. And you can't staple the whole thing closed because you need this valve to open and allow blood to move forward, right? So it is a very specific therapy, and it requires a bit of practice and expertise to really get it right. But it's been around for a while. You can see that the first generation of these little fancy staples came around in 2003 or so, and we're now just about 20 years into it, and there are multiple shapes and sizes and widths and all kind of a large decision framework to think about and how to use these to the best of our ability. We've also started using this particular technology on the tricuspid valve. And similarly, there's a new, like a TAVR-like valve that can go in the tricuspid valve as well. So I didn't focus on those because that stuff is a little more kind of fresher and less, it has been around for a little bit less time, but certainly these lessons that we first learned on the aortic and the mitral valves are now being applied quite nicely to the tricuspid as well. And so it continues to be a space where there's a lot of research, there's a lot of energy put, and we sort of learn new lessons almost by the day in some of these spaces, particularly around the tricuspid valve and new technologies coming out all the time. So I just wanted to just provide a brief overview to this extent. I didn't want to belabor it or have a really prolonged slideshow. I could talk about this for hours, but felt like that might not be the right way to spend this time. So I wanted to provide a little table setting, level setting around valvular heart disease, and then kind of open things up for everyone's questions. And so maybe I can stop sharing here if I can figure out how to do that. If
anyone has a question, you can either type that into the chat box or into the Q&A section. And one question that did come in, Jamie, from Dr. McCabe, from a patient who from within Facebook was talking specifically about the tricuspid regurgitation and the new trial, the EVOKE trial. And that heart valve. Can you talk a little bit more about what that valve does, how it's new, and maybe how some patients may qualify for that?
Yeah, absolutely. So the tricuspid valve is trickier to put a whole new valve in there, a new catheter-based valve in there, because anchoring or getting it to hook in place and stay there has been more of the difficulty. And one of the companies came out with a design that really deals with that issue by having kind of a wraparound design where it grabs the leaflets that are there and really holds onto them tightly so that it won't fall out. So the idea here is that for people who have really leaky tricuspid valves, we can just replace that valve almost like a, you know, like you'd have a surgical replacement of the valve using the leg vein to bring the valve into place. So no open heart surgery. The initial results of that valve in some experiments and, you know, about 100 patients or so in Europe have looked really, really promising. And we're very excited to have a trial of this valve here. It is still in experimental phase. So to get the valve, you have to sort of be screened by a national registry. And for people who are willing to participate in this trial, two out of every three get the valve and one out of every three does not get the valve initially, but can get it at the 1 year mark after participation for that time period. And that's unfortunately how the FDA wants this trial to run to prove that it is beneficial for folks. So so we are doing that, and it requires a bunch of quite a number of tests up front to make some determinations, including a CAT scan and some ultrasounds of the heart.
And getting into that as well. So for any heart valve procedure and finding the right treatment option, what are the heart tests that normally, diagnostic tests that are normally done to give a proper diagnosis?
Well, you know, the typical pathway for this sort of stuff is that someone hears a murmur and then orders an echocardiogram, which is an ultrasound of the heart. It's the, if for those of you who've had it, it's the one where they put the gel on your chest and then hold that probe, the sort of wand thing, to your skin. And that's the best first way to assess the heart valves. From there, and I guess one of the real values there, I should speak to that for a second, is that these are not binary things. Heart valves aren't sort of good or bad. Sometimes it's a little bit of a gray zone, right? Sometimes they can be not perfect, but working okay. And it's sort of, it can be progressive, or they can stay kind of how they are. And so helping the echocardiogram, that ultrasound, can help determine the severity of the heart valve disease too. And there are really sort of careful metrics for how we decide the severity of those valves for most of the valves, though not all of them. So if the valve is considered to be severely dysfunctional one way or another, then there may be subsequent tests. They can include a CAT scan, for example. So a CAT scan, like a three-dimensional X-ray, where it's the one where you sort of slide through that big donut. That helps us sort of see the size and the shape of the valve to figure out, you know, what would fit in there and what would hold snugly and so forth. It also helps us map out some of the surrounding structures so that we can ensure from a safety perspective that fixing a particular valve isn't going to create problems with a different part of the heart or some adjacent structure. So echoes and CAT scans tend to be the sort of primary tests. There is a fancier form of echo that's a little less pleasant. That's through the throat. Turns out the food pipe runs right next to the heart and is sort of closer to your heart than the chest wall of your skin is. Sorry about that. So sometimes we need to do an ultrasound through the throat to really get a sense for sort of how things look. But those are the primary tests.
Great. And then can you just go a little bit more into detail just about how it is determined with those tests and with the team, the structural heart team, how it's determined that you would have a less invasive treatment as opposed to, you know, something like an open heart repair or replacement?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. And it's been an evolution for a number of years. I've been in practice here for 10 years and things have changed pretty dramatically over that time period. A lot of it has to do with what studies have happened already, kind of comparing different ways of fixing a valve. And so, for example, TAVR, that aortic valve treatment, is probably the most mature therapy right now. And there have been head-to-head trials comparing open heart surgery to catheter-based valve replacement in most populations of people. And that's helped us really expand the pool of folks who can get a minimally invasive procedure. That is not true for every population of people. So largely folks who are particularly young or who have heart valves, aortic valves with two flappers, two leaflets instead of the classic three. Those are scenarios where you have to sort of talk about that a little bit more, and an open heart surgery may still be better for different reasons. But that's generally how it works, is that for each particular valve and for each particular technology, there's usually between when it comes to sort of exist in the world and when it gets to broad applicability is usually about a 10-year time horizon, while various studies are done to compare it to open heart surgery. And even in that context, studies are always talking about kind of averages, right? So the average person who is X years old, or the average person who is this tall or this big or whatever. And of course, each individual is remarkably unique. And so the averages don't work for everybody, but they do work for a lot of people. So we have, that's why we bring this multidisciplinary team to meet everyone, to so that everyone can kind of assess the individual and sort of see what might work and what might fit. And then layered on top of that, of course, there is there are the wishes of the person that we're meeting. And for some people, specific things are more concerning or more triggering or more top of mind than others. And so when you're comparing, a procedure that has these three primary risks and these couple of benefits to a procedure that has a different set of risks and a different set of benefits, that's a bit apples to oranges. And you might find a person who really cares about oranges, and you might find a person who really cares about apples, right? And so they can bring that sort of this shared decision-making, that people can bring a really important perspective in terms of what they value most as well.
Right. And I know just on a weekly basis, that's something that the team does and has been, I think, really revealing to see how that multidisciplinary team works together. In terms of the pulmonary valve, I know maybe a little bit outside of the specific expertise, but in terms of valve replacement options there, what does that landscape look like?
There are a number of pulmonary valve replacement options. We at the University of Washington, we tend to that care pathway is run by the adult congenital group, because most people who have pulmonary valve disease, they tend to have been born with it, and so that sort of falls into adult congenital. So I don't do those personally, but I do know that there are two commercially available transcatheter pulmonary valves, that are in routine use. And that's a space where it's also actually three, including one of the TAVR valves that's used there a lot. So there are options there for sure. It just happens to be that we rely on a different group of doctors to treat the pulmonary valve.
And Dr. Steinberg is our resident expert on that end, correct?
That's right. Zach Steinberg, yeah.
Great. So I'll provide his information on that description as well for the individual looking for more information there. How about in terms of sleep apnea and AFib? Does sleep apnea impact heart valves? And then additionally, do heart valve challenges cause AFib?
Well, in terms of sleep apnea, it's clearly not good for you. And it sleep apnea tends to drive blood pressure up. And then blood pressure in turn can have negative impacts on how valves perform, because it, you know, valves separate different pressure heads, right? So be above a valve and below a valve, there are different sets of pressures, and that's why they open and close, is they just are following pressure gradients. And so elevated blood pressure obviously elevates the pressure gradient between the various rooms that are separated by the valve. So so high blood pressure in general is bad for valves, and sleep apnea certainly affects your blood pressure. I don't know that sleep apnea directly affects the valves otherwise, but we know that it's not the greatest thing to have to leave untreated in general. And then in terms of AFib, it's actually the relationship between AFib and heart valves can be confusing. On the one hand, they're separate in the sense that AFib is kind of the electrical wiring of the house, if you will, and heart valves are sort of more the plumbing side of the house. However, you can get into sort of negative spirals with AFib. So AFib, which is a heart rhythm issue where you kind of lose control of your heart rate and rhythm, it's sort of, you know, your body might be sending signals to your heart saying, hey, let's do the box step. And your heart's like, no, I'm going to do the salsa and just do what they want. That's sort of how AFib works a little bit. It's just that tends to make the top chambers of the heart, the what's so-called atria, stretch and swell a little bit, or what we call get dilate. And that in turn can make mitral and tricuspid regurgitation worse. And it does that because it sort of pulls on the door frame. And so if you've got the atria are on top of the mitral and the tricuspid valve, respectively on the left and right side of the heart, sorry for all the dinging, you can, if you dilate that upper room, that upper chamber, it will pull the leaflets, the flappers, away from one another. So where they used to be doing this, now all of a sudden they're doing that. So atrial fibrillation is a very common cause, particularly of tricuspid regurgitation. On the other hand, having mitral regurgitation, so mitral backwards flow into the atrium, also precipitates makes atrial fibrillation more common, I guess I should say. So these things are intertwined, sometimes there's a chicken and egg phenomenon, kind of you meet someone and they have atrial fibrillation and they have mitral or tricuspid regurgitation, and it can be hard to know which one came first and which one came second, but now they're both present, and that's pretty common.
And then how about a question just about recovery time and what that looks like? When can people expect to be back on their feet? How would they feel after some of these treatments? What does that look like?
Yeah, most of the catheter-based valve replacement or repair options require a one-night hospitalization. Not all of them. Sometimes you can go home the same day, depending on what time of day it's done and how much observation time we have after the procedure. But typically I'd say for the majority of folks, it's one night in the hospital and then home the next morning. And the restrictions that are provided are actually rarely about the heart. They're actually more commonly in regards to the stitches that are placed on the leg artery or vein where we've gotten access. And these are typically melt away stitches that are under the skin. You don't have to take them out, but for the first handful of days, they're what are keeping the blood vessel closed so that it doesn't bleed. And we want to make sure that those don't tear or pull through. And so the restrictions are essentially that we don't want people to do strenuous exercise or lift heavy things for about 10 days. And after that, getting back into exercise is a great idea. You know, I like to joke that you don't buy a Ferrari to leave it in the garage. So once you get your new valve and your restrictions are up after 10 days or so, we really do encourage people to join cardiac rehab and sort of start building back their fitness, because invariably people with these conditions get a little out of shape. It's just hard to do the exercises and the sort of have the quality of life that you want. And so building back that muscular fitness and that kind of cardiovascular breathing fitness takes a little time. So typically you get improvement after these valve interventions right away, but then you can have sustained further improvement over the coming or the following months doing cardiac rehab and just sort of getting back into an exercise regimen.
And then is there anything else other than the exercise, rehab, and blood thinners, if you do have that mechanical heart valve, to take care of your heart valve?
No, by and large, most of these biologic valves or tissue valves don't really require blood thinners, or at least not for a long time. Some scenarios do require blood thinners for 1 to 3 months, but most don't require anything more than a baby aspirin. And we don't know of anything that helps the valves sort of that improves their durability, let's say. We do know that smoking makes any biologic valve or man-made valve worse and will help eat it up faster, or wear it down faster, maybe is a better way to say that. And then being on dialysis is also associated with kind of shorter durability of valves that are man-made valves. But aside from that, I think just general healthy living is certainly valuable to feel better, and probably also does help the valve work better too. And that includes, watching your blood pressure and doing some daily exercise. And exercise, by the way, can be defined differently for different folks, but really just means things like walking or, going up and down stairs, just being active for 15 minutes a day or something. I mean, obviously more is better perhaps, but the threshold, sometimes people have very grandiose visions of what exercise means, and they say, well, I can't do that. That's just too much. But we're not necessarily looking for that. I know it's a process to get back into strenuous exercise.
Great. Any other questions from the audience? Great. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for attending today. If you do have any questions or follow-up, please feel free to message us on the Facebook channel, Facebook page, as well as our email. You can also reach out to us via phone if you would like to have a consultation or discuss things specific to your concerns with Dr. Jamie McCabe. We had the email there available for you. And then we also have direct channels for you to call our hospital on our Facebook page again, or udevmedicine.org/heart. And we'll be sure to send you a follow-up with this webinar on demand. But thank you again, everybody, for attending. And thank you so much, Dr. McCabe.
It was my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thank you all. Bye.